So you're praying whatever denomination you want to have a gun. No, this is not a gun. It's a catadioptric lens. Yeah, I got it right. It's a catadioptric lens, and it is used to take very, very wide images. Oh, the resolution has changed on my screen. Great.
Don't worry, you can't do anything about it.
No, it's, I hope it will, okay. So, what shape is our Earth?
The plate sphere, right?
Spherical, right. And what shape is this?
Rectangle.
Mm-hmm. So, what we do when we do this is we project a sphere on a rectangle, and we can project basically anything, any image, from any source format to any target format. Now, I'm here today standing in for Tom, who unfortunately could not make it, and he developed a tool called Panini, which enables a photographer to take any input format and transform it into, or project it onto any output surface. Perspective, that's a minor part of the science of geometrical optics, and it's a major part of the language of art. And usually what we are used to see are linear projection, like the standard cameras that we have. They take a linear picture, rectilinear picture of our environment. Although with fisheye lenses, we also get to do like more curved projections. And yet, I think this image was taken from a Wikipedia page, which Tom doesn't really like so much, because that Wikipedia page still goes from the old paradigm that you're projecting on a flat surface. That may have been true in the past, where artists would paint or draw on a flat surface and would try to convey us an idea, actually an aesthetically pleasing idea of the world around us on these flat surfaces. And it dates back with those beautiful views of the 18th century called Vedutismo, where they would really go for very, very large perspectives. And those very large perspectives have intrigued people in our community, and Bruno Postel made an analysis of this particular painting by Giampaolo Pannini, which was an Italian painter in this Vedutismi movement, and came up around Christmas with a nice present. He found out the mathematical formulas to recreate this using computers and panoramic techniques. This is an analysis that Tom did of a Panini image, and it is a mix of perspective. The columns are straight, like they would be in a rectilinear perspective, but they are also distributed as if they would be in a cylindrical perspective. Now, the rectilinear perspective is that what we are most commonly acquainted to, because that's what our cameras do normally, our point and shoot, or most DSLRs. So we have been trained, our eyes have been trained to look at those straight lines. It's a rectangle with straight line, and we pay a lot of money for better and better glass from Nikon, Canon, other manufacturer, so that this glass does not distort those straight lines, because distorted straight lines are bad for the eye. They are perceived as not being aesthetical. And I'll skip on this example where, this is like a sphere. It's the basic panorama technique is I take one of those cameras and I just turn around and shoot. Like, six shots per round, and then using Hugin or another tool, I compose this equirectangular image. And once I have the equirectangular image, let me do. Whoops, no, I went too far. Okay, well, once I have such an equirectangular image, I can load it in Panini. This is Tom's tool. I have it on the desktop. And here I am. I can look around. Oops, I need to change to the sphere model. So here I am, I can move around my sphere as if I was there. Yes, please?
Demonstrations, I often think that when you pause, the images look okay, but when it's being moved, it doesn't look like I'm there. It looks like it's somehow sliding around in the corners, and I don't know what it is, whether it's the way it moves or something, but each individual still frame looks correct, but the dynamic effect doesn't look as if my head is moving around. It looks as if... Is it because I'm too far from the screen, or my angle of view is incorrect, or what
happens in your specific case, and it's a specific case of every single one of us, this it's specific to every single one of us, because every single one of us has his own point of view. You're sitting at different places in this room. Like, what do you see
rectangle.
Actually, only he should see a rectangle. All of you are correcting, but you're just seeing some sort of how do you call it in English?
Perspective.
Yeah, you see a perspective of a rectangle, but like this shape is a rhomboid?
Quadrilateral.
A quadrilateral, yes. And if I turn it this way, you see
a line.
Exactly, but I still see a rectangle. Now, this kind of viewer are made for the screen, so you need to stand just in the middle of the screen to see the way it is meant to be seen.
Okay.
And because each and every one of you is seated at another place, what we have a projection of a projection, and it might not look that right for you. And then there is another topic, but let's see first the other question.
I guess the problem Clint is referring to is basically that the horizontal view of angle is
do it again?
Yeah, you're in pole position now, so.
Yeah, okay.
Looks better?
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, sorry, I didn't hear the question.
I just said that for this distance, the audience is here. We have a too big view of angle.
Oh, the field of view?
Field of view, yeah.
Let me see.
It probably looks more natural if you're... It probably looks more natural if you're using left mouse.
Left mouse and whoops, that's okay. Yeah. Now, the other point is that those things really look better in real time, in real, like when you're in space. So we have a projecting system, actually maybe two, I'm not sure if the second one is working, but one is at the end of the exhibit, there is like an exhibit of panoramas out there, which are an application of this technique. And at the end of the exhibit, on your right, there is a room where there is a cylindrical screen and you can walk in. And even in that cylindrical screen, it is tuned for the center of the screen. So you want to try to stay as much as possible in the center of the cylinder to see it as it was meant to be projected on it. And the other one might be just on the right here when coming up. When getting out of the door, if a computer decided to work. So, yeah, back to this.
Can you press
F5? F5, okay, yeah, thank you. As you see, I pulled those slides from Tom, and here he took one equirectangular and he showed different angles of view. So here he's using a Panini projection to show 160 degrees, and here it's even 240 degrees. It's going to be too fast for me.
F11.
Yay. Okay, so here we have an old picture that is embedded in a new panorama. And the old picture is about 43 degrees wide, which is a classical rectilinear view. And the wider one is about 180 degrees. So it's not really possible to capture it with a rectilinear lens. And if there wouldn't be that old picture embedded, if I wouldn't give you this information, the picture look natural, which is the intended idea of the author. Now, here we're gonna see how I turn this panorama of mine to the picture that you can see outside at the beginning of this exhibition. I start with the equirectangular, and I compose it into a Panini projection view. The Panini projection view has like squeezed the horizontal, but the vertical still doesn't look good. We have those bulges where we would expect like a line for it to be nice. And what we can see on the image are those lines that are coming out from the vanishing point, which is in the center in this case. And the vanishing point is this important point in drawing perspective, because that's where it draws our attention to. And geometrically, everything is like focused on this vanishing point. And now using the Panini tool that you saw me moving around before, it is possible to squeeze it even further and make it visually more pleasing and achieve this end result. There are still obvious kinks, like you can see them in the benches, and they have been cropped away at the bottom, but it's still more pleasing than what would have been a comparable rectilinear view, i.e. just taking a picture with a wide angle lens, if that wide angle lens would exist. It doesn't. And so let's try to do it here in the Panini. I will load. Oops. Let's do it in the GIMP. I did it in the GIMP because Panini is still under development. It's on SourceForge. Tom is putting his efforts in there. But the proof of concept was made in the GIMP with MathMap. So, sorry, oh no, that's a slide. Where do I have to open it. I had everything open nicely, but I had to reboot. Desktop. Okay, filter, generic, math map. It seems that the GIMP people don't like math map, they hide it. Okay, now I hope I have it saved. Yes. And it seems that my laptop is slow. Okay, here it is. Okay, so now we can play around. Let's see if we can get it a little bit bigger. We can play around moving the vanishing point. This way we can like adjust, and it's like sitting the viewer somewhere else in the audience, and the more I move my vanishing point to the left, the better it should look for the people on the right. Or I can play with my V's and make it either higher or lower. Now in the Panini tool, these things will work faster because it uses GPU acceleration and it is compiled, not scripted, and the user will be able to move around those lines. Now, how much time do I have left? Yeah? Sorry? Go? Okay. I wanted to show you how we do this kind of things in Hugin. That. So I'm loading into Hugin the equirectangular image. Usually we would load like individual images taken with the camera. We would match them with control point, blend them, and produce this equirectangular. I go to the fast preview of Hugin, and at the same time I go to the Stitcher tab. Let's see how we'll have to switch between the two. Usually your typical camera will take something like this. So if I was just standing there with my normal point and shoot, that's the kind of picture that I would be taking. Now, if you have a fisheye lens, you're likely to do something like that, which captures more of your image, but kind of doesn't look right to the human eye. And now, if you want to do, where do we have it? Orthographic. If you have captured the panorama, you can extract all kinds of view, like this one. No, sorry, the other way around. Like this one, which is a view of the ceiling. And why I cannot drag. Usually I could, it's here, drag. And I can drag away and choose which direction I want to see. Like, now you see I'm turning around my sphere. Whoops, it's gone. Let's see if we can reset. No. Okay. No, it's... Oh, we have a little... reset, right. Okay. Sorry, Pablo, I drove your software crazy. So, back here. The field of view is still here, so we're back at the equirectangular. I can move it around, say I want to move the horizon, but I also can move up or down and extract any meaningful or meaningless perspective from the sphere. And it's up to you as a user, as an artist, to give it a meaning to what you extract. And you can see out here about 20 such prints where this kind of projection have been used. They are done by all of those artists spread around the world who have contributed these kind of images, whose common line is that they cannot be taken with a single shot of a common camera. So they are taken with many images. Those images are merged, they are either blended as stacks or they are positioned next to each other and blended into a panorama. And then they are projected, in the case of those images, most of them on a flat surface, some of them also on a cylinder. And we have the images exposed out here. They are meant to show that we can break out of the barriers of glass. We no longer need to buy expensive glass that doesn't introduce any distortion, because those distortion can be corrected by Houdin. And we no longer need to buy glass that gives you all the possible different field of views focal distances, because we can recreate our focal distance in the computer, and we can with the computer bend those images all the way we want them so that they can look pleasant. Now, what is pleasant is a very subjective topic, so some people like those images, some people are disturbed by them, some people especially when you take them in a place like a cyclorama, where it is really around them and immersive, and you give them this moving feeling. It's not just disturbing like it was disturbing you before, but some of them really don't feel well and want to get out of the room. So I hope that's not your feeling you have now. I hope you will find some time during the lunch break to go and have a look at those pictures that are exhibited here, and that you have the time to go and look at the projectors that are out there in at least one room, I hope the second room as well. And I see Louis with his 5 minutes paper. I think I'm done. Questions? Cave?
Question about resolution. There are different ways of creating. Say, for example, that the camera that you have behind you, the parabolic mirror.
Yeah, this one?
Yeah. So the picture you take with that, it's very distorted. So you have, at some points, things are magnified, something much more than other points. So that means that you have much higher resolution in certain parts of the image than other parts.
Yeah.
Now, when you transform that into another mapping, you're going to get, you might have those parts being then I think you understand why my question.
Yeah, I understand.
Get it out of my mouth.
Yeah.
Go ahead. What do you do with resolution?
Okay. What we do is resolution. The resolution depends on what your target is. Some of the images out there are 200 and something megapixel, and they're not bigger than that because I made a mistake of not dimensioning well my server when setting up the exhibit. So when the photographer would try to upload their gigapixel images, the server would just die. So yeah, we can have gigapixel panoramas, and we can have very low resolution panoramas, like taken with those dioptric mirror, which do single shot, and which I, as a photographer, actually refuse to use for photography because I think the resolution sucks. And not only the resolution, if you have the sun shining on it, it will ruin about 20% to 30% of your 360 degrees. So what we do about resolution is we try to capture in a resolution that is adapted to the media. And the media is just mediating between the content and the human eye. Now, the human eye has a resolution, I think it's about 60 arc seconds, something like that.
60 arc seconds, yeah.
Sorry?
Yeah, it's about 1 arc minute resolution, just about the size of Venus's disk when it's at its closest.
Yeah, the size of Venus's disk when it's at its closest. And smaller than that, we cannot resolve. This translates in about 21,600 pixel for the 360 degrees. With this setting, which is already quite old, it's about 4 years old, you can achieve about 7,000 and something pixel resolution, horizontal. And it's amazing how it is enough to put you in an immersive environment, really your size, because it's different if you're projecting something or if it is printed. It depends on the distance at which you view it. There are a number of factors to consider. At some point, we are hitting limits. Like if you will go in the other room, you will see Sebastian and his team. They have a projecting system that corrects for perspective problems, which means it doesn't matter whether you put your projector straight or sideways. But if you put it too much sideways, it doesn't help how much resolution it has. It just won't work. So there are limits that we are hitting there. Does this give you an idea, or is there?
It's going to be the last question.
So, not so much a question as a comment. Can you flip back to where you were tweaking the parameters?
Okay, to where I was tweaking the parameters. Ding. Here, yeah.
Oh, actually, when you're doing it in real time.
Yeah. It was hugging. Okay, here.
Yep. So I guess my question is: has anyone tried hooking up a MIDI controller to this to be able to control multiple parameters at the same simultaneously with knobs and so on?
Well,
so it would seem like you could almost do, you know, some kind of performance with this in real time. It could be a lot of fun, I think.
Yeah. Well, at the moment, as you see, I'm switching between two views because this tool is actually meant to create photos. It was never meant for videos or for real-time interaction. We had this task preview introduced last year at the Google Summer of Code. It was one of our projects, and it introduced this level of interactivity. And one of the things I've asked from the developers was, why don't we put those parameters here, like the field of view in here?
Oh,
the sliders, yeah. So you can sort of, but it's not really meant for a live performance. Like I've been asking for the numbers because I'm faster keying in the number because I know more or less which direction I want to go and I know how many degrees I want. So I prefer to put in those fields, but other people might prefer sliders with a track, but it's not that fun. And We can definitely use some of your user interface love that you're giving to GIMP.
Yeah, but I think for this Panini tool that Tom is working on, this will have probably even more parameters. For this, it would be really nice to have. Sorry.
Yeah, so for this Panini tool Tom is actually working on, it will have much more parameters than we have seen here. So for this MIDI keyboard or something like this would be really nice, I think.
Yeah, but Panini, Tom is really developing it with the idea of... did I close it? Yes, I did. Oh, man. Okay. Anyway, Panini is meant to be a more interactive tool that gives photographer this visualization. Houdini is more the authoring tool to stitch them together. And you cannot have a tool that does really everything for everybody. And Panini is really meant to be the interactive tool where people can take what they have shot and composed with Houdini and play around with it. And there as well, your user interface input is very welcome. So I think I've finished, or are there any other questions? I'll try to be short. I don't.
Okay, so that we're.
Yeah, I'm just clarifying the resolution question, which as I understood it. So when you have the distorting camera and you take one picture and then create the panorama in your image, you might end up having resolution differences within the image, within the areas. Is this distracting for the view? Can it be?
Well, you always have some resolution areas when moving from one projection to another, because every projection has a different way of distributing pixels. And as long as the pixel density is reasonable compared to the media you're displaying it and the eye that is looking at it, there are not that many problems dealing with that. I mean, you can always do anti-aliasing, resizing, whatever need to be done. If you don't have enough pixel density, if you have just, say, one pixel for that whole screen, then there is nothing any software can do. With this kind of setting, in the really ideal condition, I get about 900 pixels around as a diameter, and you can calculate how much it will give you as an around. It's about 2,500 pixels maybe, and that's assuming that the mirror resolves well, that everything is really excellent. So 2,500 pixels on the horizontal line to make a 360 and display on one of today's modern projectors of 1900s, it's sort of not enough because you will not have enough resolution. But to make like one of those little thumbnail-sized panoramas that you sometimes see on website, that's enough. The other disadvantage of this is that you don't have the up and down, while with the fisheye stitched, I have the whole sphere around me. I think that. That answers your question?
Sort of?
Okay, so we can talk later.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.